Welcome back. This is the last of the video 15 episodes. With a change in presenter, Iain Morrison shows how to optimize the use of turnout feedbacks using the approach to a multi-platform station as an example to compare different methods of use.
Taking all the lessons that you've learned from the various videos on the occupancy feedback on turnouts, what we've done here is put them into a slightly more real-world example of a station which has one upline, as you can see here, six platforms and one downline. We want everything to come in on the upline, we want everything to go out on the downline, but at the same time we want the upline to be able to access all platforms and all platforms to be able to access the downline. So that's achieved by having this very simple scissors type operation here. And what we've done is we've put an individual turnout occupancy feedback on each turnout, as you can see here, and one on the crossover. So that's a total of eight turnouts with one crossover, which is nine occupancy feedbacks in total. In this example, which as you can see is exactly the same track layout, there is one slight difference, and that is that we've only used one feedback. So one feedback means anything on any of the turnouts or the crossover means everything is occupied. And in the final example, we have a slightly different solution where we've optimized it for the particular layout that we have here. And you have one occupancy feedback, which is covering everything on the top. You have one occupancy feedback that's covering everything on the bottom, and one occupancy feedback covering the crossover. So how does it all work? Well, let's take three trains and stick them on here, and you can see. And if we do that, and we'll put that one there, and we'll use the same starting scenario in each one. So the OBB rail car, we want it to actually go into the top half, ideally into the middle. So all I did there was because it was restart it each time to make it choose a track that I want to, and we can reuse that each time. So that's now traveling forward and it goes through and it's occupying these turnouts. Now at the same time, the Weimar says I'm ready to go now. It can't go because the route is taken by the rail car and the turnout is occupied by the rail car. However, the RHB tractor might say, well, I'm ready to go, and it can go quite easily because the downline line is clear and it's able to choose a route to exit the station. And as it progresses through, it exits the station very nicely. The OBB rail car has finally made it to its platform and will simulate the RHB tractor having moved off the layout by just deleting it from there, which therefore allows the Weimar rail car to actually progress on its journey out. Remember, it's been sat there waiting for a route out of the station. So it's got its route out of the station and it's accelerating through, as you can see, because the blue bar is getting bigger. And now it's coming to a stop at the end of the block. And if we simulate that having disappeared off the layer by just deleting it, so we'll just do that. As you can see, the OBB rail car now wants to go, so it's coming out along here. And we'll just simulate it going through the turnouts by occupying each one, and it's now disappeared off the layout like that. So that's the Rolls-Royce of solutions. If we now repeat that same scenario with the same trains on the same station layout, but what we're going to do is we're going to have it running with just one feedback covering everything. So let's just restart that to get it to go into the same place. So that is now occupying all the turnouts, as you can see here. If I start the RHP tractor, if I start the Weimar, it can't get out because the route is taken, but the RHP tractor cannot get out either because everything is occupied in the station throat by this one train. When it comes out and gets into its platform, so it gets in its platform, then the Weimar can get out. And once the Weimar has actually got out, again, we'll simulate it having gone off the rest of the layout, it allows the RHP tractor to get out. But the important lesson was shown there that nothing could move from the bottom half of the station to exit, even although it had a clear route, because all the turnouts were occupied by the lower, by having only one occupancy feedback. So we simulate that having gone, and now you can see that the rail car has a route out. So again, we'll now delete that, and we'll come to the final example down the bottom, where if we place the trains in exactly the same way that we had them running before, we should see that we get the same performance as we did with the having 9 feedbacks. So we'll start the rail car, and we'll start it a couple of times to get it to go into the same place. So we started the rail car, it's now progressing, and it's occupied these ones here. The Weimar wants to leave, but it, so we've said it's ready to go, it can't go, and we've said, okay, the RHP tractor is ready to leave as well. It can get out. So the RHP tractor is able to progress through here without any issues whatsoever and disappear off to the right-hand side. Meantime, the OBB rail car is progressing itself through the station throat. The RHP tractor has left the layout. The Weimar can now get out, and it's hit that first turnout feedback, so it's now occupied that bit. It crosses over the crossover, and then it gets onto that. It releases those two. It's into there, releases that, and then we'll get it into here, and we'll simulate it having now driven off the layout by just simply deleting it, which allows the rail car to come out. And you can see it's highlighted. You notice it changes from gold to red to show that it's occupied. And then it comes off here on the right. And again, we'd simulate that it has left the layout by just deleting it. Hopefully that shows you that with a little bit of thinking, you can actually reduce the cost of implementing occupancy on turnouts significantly. In this example, we've gone from 9 down to 3, so we've had a 67% reduction in the cost of occupancy feedbacks, a 67% reduction in the wiring, and a similar reduction in the complexity of actually configuring iTrain. So hopefully that shows you what can be done and gives you a few more examples to think about on your own layouts and how you could implement this going forward.